The Second World War is preceded by a number of important political and military events. One of the major events is the birth of Nazism. On January 30th, 1933, the German Premier von Hindenburg calls on Adolf Hitler to take over the chancellery of the Third Reich. Originally, the meeting place of the National Socialists was a Munich beer hall, where in 1923, the original putsch was created. On January 28, 1933, after the burning of the Reichstag, Marshal von Hindenburg proclaims an exceptional decree, suspending all individual rights under the existing constitution and giving Hitler full dictatorial power. This is the beginning of the Hitler regime. The dissolution of the individual federal states, the abolishment of political parties with the exception of the Nazi Party, the control of cultural and economic life, and the beginning of rearmament, first done clandestinely. As to foreign policy, Hitler proposes the annexation of countries of German-speaking people and the recapture of colonies. The first demand is the annexation of Austria. In order to protect the country from Nazi hands, Austria's premier, Chancellor Dollfuss, tries to create a regime of a cooperative character. And with Italy's support, on March 16, 1934, creates the Roman Protocols. On July 25th of the same year, the Nazis try a coup in Vienna and assassinate Dollfuss. Italy sends a few divisions to the Austrian border. Hitler denies the coup, but in Vienna reforms the government and places Chancellor Schuschnigg as premier. In 1935, during the election in the Saar, after 91% favorable votes, it is annexed by the Third Reich, in spite of the Versailles Treaty. On October 3, 1935, after an incident in Ethiopia, Italy invades that country with its expeditionary forces. The League of Nations condemns the act of aggression and applies economic sanctions. Benito Mussolini declares the Italian Empire with the conquest of Ethiopia. As the conflict closes in Africa, another opens in Spain. Francisco Franco begins an open revolt against the Popular Republican government on July 26, 1936. Franco's nationalists received military aid from Italy, Germany, and Portugal. The Republican forces received their aid from France, Great Britain, Russia, and the United States. Spain undergoes a terrible civil struggle that will last for 3 years and leave its scars for many years to come. Roosevelt is re-elected President of the United States on November 3, 1936. If Europe lives in turmoil, Asia is overcome by the Chinese-Japanese conflict, which starts after an incident at the Marco Polo Bridge, located about 25 miles from Peking. Hostilities begin at midnight on July 27, 1937. Japan occupies Peking and Tenzing and will proceed with its advance for years. Japan and Germany conclude a non-aggression pact on November 25, 1936. Italy will also adhere to this pact and will sign a tri-party pact in Berlin. Thank you. The bonds between Berlin and Rome are becoming stronger. Mussolini goes to Germany on September 26, 1937, at which time Hitler and Mussolini conclude that they want peace and will fight communism. Hitler, having decided to annex Austria, calls Chancellor Schuschnigg to Berchtesgaden, Hitler's vacation headquarters, and proposes unacceptable terms to Austria's government. German troops enter Austria. Italy and Great Britain, in a cordial atmosphere, sign a pact respecting each other's interests in the Mediterranean and in Africa. Hitler goes to Rome from May 3rd to May 9th to recognize the frontier at Brenner Pass. Germany announces the reinstitution of the German-speaking countries, including the Sudetenland, which was originally independent under the Versailles Treaty. War seems imminent. A meeting in Monaco between Hitler, British Premier Chamberlain, French Premier Daladier, and Mussolini seems for a short period to save the peace. But this is a temporary situation. Every country is rearming. September 1938. After the Treaty of Monaco, the German troops invade Czechoslovakia and occupy the Sudetenland. Thank you. To appease the West, and for other political reasons, Hitler stipulates a good neighbor policy between Germany and France, defining the reciprocal frontier. Pope Pius XI dies on February 10, 1939. The conclave elects Cardinal Eugenio Pacelli as Pope Pius XII. He will try to preserve the peace. Hitler breaks the Pact of Monaco and orders German troops to occupy the Republic of Czechoslovakia, making it a German protectorate. Monsignor Tiso, a German sympathizer, keeps his position. In spite of the German-French treaty, Germany accelerates the construction of the West Wall, or Siegfried Line, started in 1937 to oppose the French Maginot Line. These lines of fortifications are marvels of engineering, with many levels of underground passages and underground cities housing people, communication centers, and ammunition depots. The German engineer in charge of the Siegfried Line is Todt. It is a strange peace in Europe. On April 7, 1939, without advising Germany, Italy invades Albania. The occupation is done without any resistance. King Vittorio Emmanuel of Italy assumes the crown of Albania. On May 6, 1939, the reigning monarch of Great Britain, George VI, goes on an official visit to the United States and meets with President Roosevelt. This event signifies the solidarity between the two countries. In Berlin on May 21st, 1939, Germany and Italy conclude the Pact of Steel, indicating a strong alliance between these two countries. This pact is signed by the ministers of foreign affairs, Ciano representing Italy and von Ribbentrop representing the Third Reich. The problem of the Danzig territory becomes acute. If Europe is under dark clouds, the situation in the Orient is also critical. Japan, after taking over three strategic positions in China, places military blockades on the British and French possessions in Tenzing. British forces are rushed to the scene. Russia, although not facing immediate danger, reorganizes its army and modernizes its weapons. Great Britain and France try to reach a political pact with Russia. Unfortunately, on the 24th of August, the ministers of foreign affairs, Molotov for the USSR and von Ribbentrop for the Reich, sign a Russian-German treaty in the presence of Russian Premier Stalin. This pact has a secret clause. It decides the partition of Poland and other important areas. Armed with this pact, Hitler decides to solve the problem of annexation of Danzig and reveals his decision to invade Poland. Any peace mediation is futile. Great Britain and France assure Poland of their intervention in case Poland is attacked. On September 1, 1939, the powerful German forces march on Poland. The High Commissioner of the League of Nations in Danzig flees the city in anticipation of the arrival of Nazi troops. London and Paris mobilize, trying to keep their word and present Germany with an ultimatum. Great Britain intensifies its naval blockade. The Second World War has begun. On September 1, 1939, German troops invade Poland. German forces are divided into five armies, attacking all along the Polish frontier. The commanding general of the operation is von Brausewitz. Germany's air force, unopposed, is master of the skies. German parachutists attack Polish forces from the rear as they are battered in front by armored divisions. In spite of overwhelming odds, the Polish army offers a heroic resistance. For Germany, it's a test of new weapons and new fighting methods, tanks and its Stuka dive bomber. The Polish campaign is characterized by a lightning war of Blitzkrieg, an encircling war that destroys all methods of fortification and defense. The German armored columns advance and destroy all resistance. The Polish city of Gdynia is hammered by naval bombardment. It is occupied just a few days before Danzig, which is occupied on September 13, 1939. After the occupation, Hitler visits Danzig. The German army crosses the Vistula and Naru rivers. Krakow falls, and thousands of prisoners are taken and sent to concentration camps. On the southern front, German troops, having descended to the Carpathians, try to encircle the Polish troops. Hitler inspects the front lines. The Polish army is in a complete state of disarray and retreat. In one operation at Kutno, the Germans take 170,000 prisoners to be shipped to concentration camps. According to the German-Russian pact, the Russian army enters Poland and takes over the eastern part. Marshal Goering, supreme Nazi commander of the German Air Force, agrees with Hitler on a massive bombardment of the capital, Warsaw, and of Modlin, the last two outposts of resistance that stubbornly refused to surrender. Finally, after waves of aerial bombardment and under constant artillery fire, Warsaw falls on September 27th. Modlin falls on the 28th. The Polish government officials escape to Romania. The Nazis continue to persecute the Jews in Poland, forcing them to live in ghettos, sending them to forced labor camps, or deporting them to concentration camps in Germany. Though they are helpless to aid Poland, Great Britain and France declare war on Germany on September 3, 1939, in order to honor their pledge of intervention. To show an act of intervention on behalf of the Anglo-French forces, the French advance into no man's land between the Maginot and the Siegfried lines. A German counterattack repulses the French forces to their original positions. In the meanwhile, Great Britain places a blockade on German shipping. Germany reacts with submarine and air attacks. The first naval casualty of the war is the ship Athenia. Subsequently, the British aircraft carrier Courageous is sunk in the English Channel by a Nazi U-boat. In a naval engagement in the South Atlantic, three British cruisers engage the battleship Graf Spee, and after inflicting heavy damage, force it to find refuge in Montevideo, Uruguay. The Uruguayan authorities offer the Graf Spee two alternatives: give up or take to the high seas. To evade capture, the Germans sink their battleship on December 17, 1939. Months after Nazi and Soviet troops occupy Poland, Stalin makes demands on Finland that could not be granted without giving up Finland's independence. Suddenly, the Russians attack Finland on November 30, 1939. This event was preceded by an action in the Baltic states. A Russian-German pact admitted they should be under Russian ownership. Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania are already under Soviet rule. Russians attack on four fronts, in the north to the port of Petsamo, in the center with a double force to cut the country in two, in the south with a double maneuver to the north of Lake Ladoga and against the Isthmus of Karelia. Unfortunately for the Russians, the Finns are hardy, well-trained, and used to bitter weather, as the temperature drops to 30 degrees to 50 degrees below zero. Also, the daylight hours are very short, and the Soviet troops are continually harassed in Finland's dense forests. The heroic resistance of the Finns moved the world. The most vulnerable point is the Isthmus of Karelia, where the Finns place a triple defense line called Mannerheim after the Finn commander. The Russians occupy Terijoki. They install a government headed by the communist Otto Kuusinen, which is not recognized by either the Finns or the League of Nations. The Mannerheim line of defense folds back. In the northern and central sectors, the Finns hold their position and in some cases counterattack. During the two battles of Suomussalmi, from the end of the year to January 8, 1940, Finnish skiers are able to encircle Russian troops. During the middle of February, the Russians manage, with heavy troop concentrations and overwhelming forces, to break through the Finnish lines in the northern sectors of Petsamo, and in the south on the Isthmus of Karelia, against the Mannerheim line. Simultaneously, the Russians attack the port of Viripuri and land troops. All resistance ceases. first meeting for a peace treaty occurs in Sweden. The Russian terms are hard. Finland accepts and signs the treaty on March 12, 1940, after a bitter war which lasts 110 days. In April 1940, the Allies have been at war with the Nazis for 7 months. Besides a few ineffective skirmishes along the Maginot Line and the occupation of Poland, nothing has happened. On the seas, the British Navy has a supremacy. Germany, taking advantage of Norway's territorial waters, is able to supply itself with Swedish steel, loaded at the port of Narvik. The convoys are then shipped through the North Sea with military escorts. The Allies try to block this shipping by placing mines at all strategic points. Berlin, in order to gain strategic points and in order not to jeopardize this shipping, begins the invasion of Denmark and Norway. On April 9th, Germany lands troops in Copenhagen and occupies Denmark without any opposition. King Christian of Denmark tells the Danish people not to offer any resistance. The occupation takes only a few hours. The Norwegians offer much tougher resistance. Shore batteries open fire on the German naval forces and sink two cruisers. The city of Oslo is occupied shortly afterward, as are the airport and the radio station. The balance of power on April 9th is precarious indeed. The Norwegian Navy is destroyed, all major ports are occupied, and all major radio centers are in the hands of the invaders. Four German columns march from Oslo toward the interior. The resistance movement, following a plea from the king, reorganizes itself, and the whole population joins the fight. From the extreme north to Narvik, the Germans continue to land troops as well as parachutists. Allied troops send their forces to help recapture the various ports in German hands. Thank you. Many other landings continue by the Allied forces. However, the ill-trained Norwegian, French, and British troops are no match for the lightning action of the German weapons. On the seas, the fight also continues, and here the British naval supremacy is felt. In one day of naval engagements, 7 German destroyers are sunk. At the end of the naval engagements, there are more than 35 ships of various nationalities at the bottom of the fjord of Narvik. Two German columns, making their way to the interior from Oslo to join their troops at Lillehammer, give battle to the British forces and help their comrades at Trondheim. Any resistance to the German forces is futile. The Allies re-embark under German artillery fire and the Luftwaffe's Stuka dive bombers. On June 9th, the last Norwegian forces capitulate. King Haakon of Norway and his government find refuge in Great Britain. Norway is under Nazi rule. Vidkun Quisling, a Nazi partisan, assumes the rule of the nation. May 10th, 1940. Outside of a few skirmishes along the Maginot Line, there has been no new outbreak of hostilities. In Norway, some fighting still continues. Suddenly, without warning, Germany invades Luxembourg, Belgium, and Holland. Luxembourg offers no resistance and is occupied in a matter of a few hours. In Holland and Belgium, bitter fighting goes on, and the Dutch and Belgians are aided by the Allies. From the beginning, fearing a German invasion as in 1914, Belgium and the Allies studied a plan of defense. The Germans, aware that the Allies will concentrate their defense along the Schlieffen Plan, as in the First World War, enticed the Allied troops into the same area. Simultaneously, they attack at the weakest Allied position, across the Ardennes Forest. German armored divisions attack between Namur and Sedan, smashing the weak Allied positions. In Holland, the Germans use aviation. They launch an enormous number of parachutists and transport troops by air. They occupy all the airports, including Rotterdam, and take over all the bridges except those blown up by the retreating Dutch forces. All along the Dutch lines, the white flag is up. The cities and last outpost of defense in Holland are hammered by Stuka dive bombers. Holland capitulates. Queen Wilhelmina and her government find refuge in Great Britain. By predetermined strategy, the French and British troops enter Belgium on May 10th and take their places along fortified lines of defense. The Belgian lines of defense along the Albert Canal are demolished. The major forces of the French and British are pulled to the north, and unexpectedly, the German forces encircle the Allied forces. The Allied High Command is completely disoriented. Cities are heavily bombed. The civilian population is in a state of chaos, and refugees everywhere are leaving the country. The German Blitz maneuver and the quick line of continuous supplies to the front demonstrate German efficiency. The Allies, having failed to create a breach in the German forces, retreat toward the sea. Belgium falls. This is the beginning of the historic exodus of Dunkirk. The remaining Allied forces cross the English Channel, heavily bombarded by the Luftwaffe. With the exodus of Dunkirk, the Battle of Flanders is over. On June 5, 1940, the Germans start the offensive against France. The German offensive will be a perfect synchronization of the armored divisions and of the Luftwaffe. Strategically, the attack is a massive spearhead action at the River Somme and an encircling maneuver of the Maginot Line. From the Maginot Line to the sea, the French organized the Vagant plan. This is on a front of 150 miles, under constant attack and severe bombardment. The German forces cross the Somme and march toward the Seine, meeting column after column of refugees. In contrast to the surrender of the population, isolated French fighting forces continue the struggle valiantly. However, faced with large German forces supported by armored units, their resistance is futile. Panzer divisions soon occupy Rouen and Verneuil, and place a bridge on the Seine to continue their advance. All largely populated areas are under constant bombardment. The entire 10th French Army, already losing ground in front of the city of Rouen, is cut in two. The Germans moved towards St. Valery and Dieppe in order to occupy the French coast along the English Channel between the deltas of the Somme and the Seine rivers. All remaining Allied ships are bombarded by sea and shore artillery. To the east of the Somme line, the Germans cross the Aisne River near Soissons. Placing new bridges, they cross with their tanks and employ an enormous encircling maneuver from east to west near the Swiss borders. The Maginot Line is completely surrounded, from the west at the Ardennes Forest to east of the Jura Mountains. The German advance is in full force. Paris is in danger, and on June 10th, the government abandons the capital city. The German reserves along the Siegfried Line, together with the German forces on the opposite side, open fire on the Maginot Line, squeezing in the middle. After a prodigious artillery barrage, the Germans smashed the Maginot Line in three sectors. The Germans advance toward the interior of France on all fronts, finding only sporadic resistance. The retreat organized by General Weygand is completely smashed by the German panzer division. The French surrender by the tens of thousands. On June 10th, Italy enters the war. On June 14th, German troops enter Paris, declared an open city. Thank you. Marshal Pétain of France, head of the provisional government, communicates to the French population that he has asked Hitler for an armistice. Germany continues its occupation of France, finding almost no resistance. French and German officials discuss armistice trusts, which will be argued on June 22nd. Hitler arrives in Paris and finds a deserted city. In London, General de Gaulle organizes the French troops stationed in Britain after the Dunkirk exodus. He implores the French people to join in the common fight. For France, de Gaulle declares, the war is not yet lost.
Un'ora segnata dal destino. L'ora delle decisioni irrevocabili. La dichiarazione di guerra è già stata consegnata agli ambasciatori.
On June 10th, 1940, Italy enters the war. The Italian army, headed by the Prince of Savoy, is on the eastern border of France. Action is limited, as the French are well entrenched and fortified. From the north and northwest, the French are routed by the strong German advance that encircled the Maginot Line. On the Italian front, the French are the first to attack. On a counterattack, the Italians occupy Mentone at the Italian-French border on the French Riviera. France, already defeated by the Germans, asks for an armistice to be signed on June 24th. The fall of France gives the Italian Navy predominance in the Mediterranean, and they use mines to blockade the Sicilian Canal in the middle of the sea. Thank you. The British fleet retreats toward Alexandria and Gibraltar, which dominates all naval transport access to the Mediterranean. Italian submarines succeed in entering Gibraltar and sink Allied ships. In the Libyan desert of Africa, at the beginning of the hostilities, there are two Italian armies, the 10th under General Berti and the 5th under General Garibaldi. The supreme commander is General Balbo, soon replaced by Marshal Graziani. On September 13th, the Italian offensive occupies Saloum, and on September 16th, two armored columns occupy Sidi El Barani. British send reinforcements to the Egyptian front for the 8th British Army, as well as new model tanks and new gun turrets. On December 9th, 1940, General Wavell begins a large offensive, a difficult fight in a torrid climate among sandstorms. Tobruk, Bardia, and Gararoub are isolated, but the defending Italian troops fight until March before surrendering. The 8th British Army reaches Dernia and Benghazi. Serenica falls. In 2 months, the British troops advance approximately 24 miles. General Wavell's counteroffensive has been extremely successful due to the superiority and the coordination of the action between the Air Force and the armored divisions. In Libya, the Italian forces are blocked by the British Navy. In July, naval battles take place at Punto Stilo and Capo Spada. Difficulties increase for the Italian troops, and the Italian convoys are afflicted by the British Navy. The British Navy, however, suffers heavy losses from Italian U-boats. The Italian Air Force, although inferior in number and power, attacks Malta and Tobruk and makes innumerable raids in the Red Sea. In East Africa, Italian troops commanded by the Duke of Aosta penetrate the Sudan and take over the city of Kassala in Kenya, and subsequently conquer British Somaliland. Their success is short-lived. On all fronts, from the Sudan, from Kenya, and from the sea, the British move on a counterattack. The heroic resistance of the Italian soldiers is demolished. The African Empire falls.